Right.
Yes.
Thank you very much. Yap, thank you for that gracious introduction. First of all, let me say in all honesty that I'm flabbergasted that so many of you are here tonight, particularly on a night of Champions League football. Bill Shankly, the very famous manager of Liverpool back in the 1970s, he said that some people say that football is a matter of life and death, but it's much more important than that. But I see that at least in Maastricht, there are at least a couple of hundred of you who don't believe that, so that's to my benefit. So my first remark is to say a big thank you for coming this evening. What I'm going to try to do is to talk for an hour, because that's, I understood, is the limit of your tolerance. I know that, for example, when you're speaking, an hour seems like a nanosecond, and when you're listening, it seems like eternity in hell. But for an hour, and give you a sort of sense of, you know, what's happening at NATO these days. How do we see the world? What are the things that we're doing well? What are the things that we're struggling with, quite frankly? What are some of the policy dilemmas that we have to confront as we go forward? I start, though, with a sort of a recollection. Because the last time I was here, speaking here at Maastricht to the European Centre for Journalism, I can't remember the exact date, but it was just around the turn of the century, just after the Kosovo Air campaign in 1999, when I came to speak about media and strategic communications. And I remember at that time, I was obviously much younger, but I was full of optimism for the future shape of the international security order. NATO had just carried out what we considered to be a humanitarian operation to stop ethnic cleansing in Kosovo. The air campaign didn't go very smoothly. I'm the first person to acknowledge that. Lots of mistakes were made, but at least we sort of came away sort of thinking, well, we managed to prevent the 100,000 casualties that we'd seen in Bosnia. There was no Srebrenica massacre in Kosovo. We acted reasonably early. We got the refugees back there, home, within weeks before they spread out irretrievably across Europe. And we put down a marker that with military forces, it is possible to reconstruct failed or failing states. Referring to UN peacekeeping operations, we used the term to paint the world blue. Military humanitarianism was not an oxymoron. And indeed, there was hope of a new world order, that the forces of globalization would inevitably sort of spread democratic values, and that security could be based on the power of ideas rather than the power of tanks. Now, I have to acknowledge the first thing, and it's not just because I'm 15, 16 years older now than I was then, but there is no doubt that it's very difficult today to give such an upbeat assessment. Whatever your political ideology or your views, nobody could deny that we have experienced a great deterioration in security around us. Now, how permanent, how deep this is going to be is something that academics can still debate. For example, a few years ago, very noted Harvard sociologist Steven Pinker published a brilliant book called The Better Angels of Our Nature, whereby he demonstrated with massive scholarship that the incidence of violent conflict was going down, there were fewer conflicts, fewer people were dying, 10 times as many people were being killed as a result of organized crime than due to violent conflict in the world. So ergo, the world was becoming, grosso modo, notwithstanding pockets of violence, a more civilized place. Whether Syria and the current terrible war there, with nearly 300,000 dead and about 14 million people displaced, 6 million of them refugees beyond the borders, whether Syria sort of contradicts that thesis as conflicts elsewhere, is a point we can debate. Probably the evidence is not quite there yet. But what we do see, is a return to violence and insecurity, and no longer far away in Afghanistan, but increasingly on our doorstep. I mean, Ban Ki-moon, the Secretary General of the United Nations, gave an interesting speech the other day where he noted that there are 120 million people in the world who are currently in need of humanitarian assistance, and that means that the UN has to find $20 billion dollars a year. It's only got half that money, apparently, to care for these people. 60 million people are currently displaced. This is the largest number ever in human history. And in 2014, according to the United Nations, the cost of armed conflict, not organized crime, in the world was just slightly under $15 trillion, vis-a-vis a global economic output of $74 trillion. So the number of people displaced or directly involved in armed conflict, the number of people requiring humanitarian assistance as a result of failed states, is growing. Now, again, we can spend a lot of time this evening, ladies and gentlemen, trying to sort of figure out exactly why that has happened. I mean, some people believe that, you know, the forces of globalization have gone into reverse, that globalization used to be about what we, the West, could do to the rest of the world, and now it seems more what the rest of the world is able to do to us in an increasingly wired, globalized economy, where it's easier for people to discover where the good life is, and it's easier for people to move, and there are a number of networks to facilitate that. Others have put, for example, like neoconservatives in the United States, have put more the emphasis on the return of geopolitics and the return of great powers. Certainly, if you look at, for example, statistics in the military balance of the International Institute of Strategic Studies, which came out just a couple of days ago, you do see that countries like Russia, Saudi Arabia, which is now the fifth largest arms spender in the world, China, of course, unsurprisingly, Iran, have been increasing their military budgets. The technology gap has narrowed significantly between the United States and the West and these new entries into the field of geopolitics. So we may not believe that there is a military solution to problems, but a number of other countries in the world, look at Russia in Syria or Assad, clearly do believe that there is a military solution to problems, and are only too happy to demonstrate that this, in fact, works, at least not in our terms, but in their terms. So the old gap whereby the United States was responsible for about 50% of global defense spending all by itself up until recently is no longer particularly the case. In fact, in Europe, for example, the average of military spending is now 1.1% of GDP, which is the lowest that it has been since the period of the 1920s. So some argue that this sort of displacement of the locus of military power is encouraging a sort of a sense that, once again, as Frederick the Great would have put it, back in the days of 18th century Prussia, that diplomacy without arms is like music without instruments. Others will point, obviously, to the collapse of the Arab Spring in particular, and the cost of removing dictators, whether it be in Libya or Iraq, you know, the Gaddafis, the Saddam Husseins of this world, without having any viable sort of alternative system to put in place. Putin, of course, is very keen at pointing out all of the time, as in his recent speech to the UN General Assembly last September, look what you have done, look what you have done. In terms of, you know, removing somebody who may not have been particularly salubrious, Ben Ali in Tunisia, one can think of lots of these people, but at least provided some kind of order and was able at least to keep terrorism, local jihadism, effectively contained. And clearly, if there is a valid criticism of the Western interventionism over the last 20 years, it was being very effective at removing regimes, but not very good at putting new ones in their place. In Afghanistan, nearly 20 years on, we're still struggling with NATO with that particular dilemma. Decentralizing the effort to local forces, of course, is all very well in theory, but it's much more difficult in practice. And in places like Afghanistan and more recently Iraq, the United States, having largely withdrawn, has been obliged to go back in, not with the same numbers as in the past, but still with significant numbers increasing all the time. The conclusion seems to be that the locals are only prepared to fight when they are directly financed and directly supported by the United States or Western powers. So we could spend a lot of time, and there's probably lots of other theories to explain why we've experienced this great deterioration. If you're a historian, and I know some of you in the audience tonight are historians, you could even argue that it's a kind of fatality of Hegelian laws of history that we always believe after the end of one kind of conflict, like the Cold War or the Napoleonic Wars or the First World War or even the Second World War, that somehow we've sort of moved into a new phase of humanity, a new golden age where the old laws of power politics no longer apply, where it's no longer mighty is right, and that we can construct the international edifice according to international organization or a new set of rules of the road. And inevitably, as after the Napoleonic Wars and after the First World War and the Second World War, those kind of dreams tend to sort of fade away as we realize that history bites us back. So perhaps that's a theory as well. But whatever your particular views, ladies and gentlemen, the fact of the matter is that we are in a mess. The problems are likely to get worse before the solutions, if there are solutions, kick in. This weekend, all of us in the security policy community were at the latest, the 51st edition of the Munich Security Conference, the big gathering of the priesthood every February in Munich, where you have 60 foreign ministers, 30 heads of state. And I was struck by the, not just the mood of doom and gloom, but the fact that everybody was brilliant. You know, John Kerry, I can name the names, John McCain, everybody who got up to speak, brilliant at analysing the problems. Nobody was able really to come up with any kind of solution. So first of all, that is it. You know, at what level can we stop this decline and can we begin to rebuild? Secondly, if we're bumping along from crisis to crisis, as we tend to be, the EU is overloaded at the moment by six simultaneous crises, more than any of in its history, and this is sucking the oxygen out of any kind of long-term planning. Long-term planning is not sexy, you don't see the immediate results, you have to believe, but at the same time, if you just bump along from crisis to crisis and don't do long-term strategy, you're not going to ultimately move forward either. The adversaries of yesteryear were comparatively easy to defeat. When I remember the Milosevic's, the Gaddafi's, the Saddam Hussein's, these people were essentially isolated. They didn't have allies. Even within their own countries, they were largely contested. Their military forces weren't particularly loyal to them, if at all. So they could be removed, even if we didn't know what we would always put in their place. Today's adversaries are formidable. They have allies, they have networks. I mean, what we're learning, for example, about Russia is that it may be less powerful militarily than the Soviet Union, but it has far more levers over our societies because of investments in media, investments in banking, investments in far right, not far left. The communists used to fund far left parties. Putin funds far right parties. The instigation of populism, the ability, as you saw just a couple of weeks ago, when the Russians brilliantly organized a propaganda campaign around a Russian-German girl who they alleged was raped by migrants in Berlin, to accuse the German government and the police of not being able to protect our girl, as Lavrov called this German citizen, albeit of Russian descent. So brilliant at sort of finding the fault lines. Putin doesn't create the fault lines, but he's great at exploiting them to undermine our faith in our own system, our own values, our government. We may not believe in Putin's truth, but we increasingly doubt the other version of the truth as well. Think of what you experienced in the Netherlands here with the myriad interpretations of who shot down the Malaysian aircraft over eastern Ukraine. Nobody believed the Russian version, but nobody quite knew what the alternative truth was either as a result. So contrary to the Soviet Union, Russia now is inside our system in a way that the Politburo never was in the old days. So the current adversaries are not going to be knocked down. They're not going to go away easily. Even with low oil prices, they have resources to stay in the fight, if I can use that expression, for some considerable time to come. So there are no quick fixes, no air campaign, no quick intervention is going to right the ship. Whatever issue you look at, whether it be the East or the South, we're in this for the long haul. If the analogy of the Cold War applies, and I would argue it doesn't apply yet, totally. There is no total overlap between Cold War I and Cold War II. Nonetheless, what we see is a situation where it's going to take 30 years and a lot of money and a lot of effort before we can hope to be back to the rather halcyon European order that we experienced, notwithstanding the collapse of Yugoslavia, after the fall of the Berlin Wall and throughout much of the 1990s. Indeed, one of the regrets that I think we all have is that somehow we managed to spend somewhere in the region of $5 to $6 trillion on Iraq and Afghanistan, not achieving the results that we wanted, wasting a large amount of this money. For example, Joe Stiglitz of Columbia University, who you remember used to be at the World Bank some years ago, IMF as well, he's done a brilliant calculation that the United States will be paying for Iraq for the next 50 years in the same way that it didn't stop paying for the World War II until the beginning of the 1980s. And the cost of caring for all of the vets of Afghanistan and Iraq, plus replacing all of the equipment, will run pretty much at the end of the cycle in more or less to the same amount, about $4 to $5 trillion. And if you're spending a lot of money on liquidating yesterday's conflicts, it doesn't, unfortunately, give you many additional resources that you need to spend mitigating the conflicts of the future or today. We would dearly love to have all that money back in the hope that we could spend it more wisely next time around. So we face, therefore, in NATO, and this is where I come to NATO, finally, you say, but I come to it now, a unique situation. For the first time in our history, we can't do one thing at a time. And in most of my years at NATO, we've been in a lucky position that, you know, we could devote all of our energy, all of our resources, effectively or less effectively, on dealing with one issue. You know, fortunately, Bosnia was more or less pacified, if not ultimately successful, when Kosovo came along. The Kosovo air campaign had stopped by the time that 9/11 swung round and we had to confront Afghanistan. We'd taken the decision to withdraw from Afghanistan, at least with a combat mission, when the French and the UK decided to tackle Benghazi and the situation in Libya. So this has been, a very happy situation to be in. Now we face, as I mentioned, a number of crises simultaneously. Now, on the one hand, I think of Charles Dickens when I think of this situation. You remember in The Tale of Two Cities, Dickens begins with the immortal opening line, "It was the best of times, it was the worst of times." And I suppose for a NATO sort of bureaucrat like myself, it's the best of times in the sense that, you know, this kind of existential crisis that the alliance seemed to be facing post-Afghanistan, you know, what we were going to do with ourselves, you know, no more intervention, no threats, coming back to a Europe where which was largely pacified, a bit of mopping up in the Balkans, and on the fringes of Europe, a few frozen conflicts in Moldova or Georgia to deal with, but nothing more. We would be bored. It would be the end of history, at least for NATO. And of course, now, you know, if you could argue in a kind of perverse way that a security organization like NATO needs threats in its DNA, obviously the NATO ambassadors have a spring in their stride. You know, they have got lots of big dossiers to get their teeth into. But it's the worst of times because we risk being overwhelmed. For instance, one group of allies, as you could well imagine, believes that the threat is largely from the East. George Soros, the other day in the newspaper, you know, forget about ISIL, Putin is what you should be worrying about. There is the long-term strategic threat. But if you're in the south of Europe, as you can well imagine, it looks very different. With the migrant crisis, also with failed and failing states just on the other side of the border, with ISIL now having expanded to 32 different countries and having established mini caliphates in 11 different countries, not just on the borders of Syria and Iraq, with this chain reaction of instability across the Middle East, that is looking a lot more dangerous. The Turkey, you referred to the chap, the Turkey, I'll come back to this later, Russia situation in Syria, shows this. And so clearly you want the NATO organisation to devote at least 50% of its time and resources to your particular region.
region and not be in a situation where you're spending your defence budget largely to the benefit of three or four allies in the East. You know, we live in an age where, you know, what I put in is also what I get back. Generosity has to be the name of the game. For example, we had a defence minister's meeting just last week at NATO, where the Polish defence minister, having registered the fact that the United States had announced a 3.4 billion package for the reinforcement of Eastern Europe with two additional American brigades, pre-positioned equipment, exercises. Polish defence minister said, fine, now I've got this, I'll give you four F-16s.
Now we've got this, we'll do a little bit for the South. But quid pro quo, we want to see our own front secure, and to that extent, we'll go south. I mean, for example, if you look at Estonia, army 3,500, obviously the great beneficiary at the moment of NATO's assistance in terms of deterrence and reassurance. But the Estonians realised that obviously they've got to do something for the others. So you've got an Estonian company in the Central African Republic at the moment. These, therefore, like the Polish F-16s, may not be proportionate to what they're receiving, but at least it plugs in, I think, to the new narrative of European security, which is I scratch your back and you scratch mine. We have got to, you know, if you want me to be receptive to your particular problem, you've got to show understanding and receptivity for mine. But balancing East and South is going to be the main theme of what I'm going to say to you this evening, because it's the central dilemma that NATO faces. What is the most immediate threat? What is the most existential threat? Where can we best devote our resources to best effect? Are the problems similar? Does a single strategy work for both, or do you need separate strategies? How can you mobilise sufficient resources in either direction? Now, the starting point is the East, and it's the easiest one for me to start with. Why? Well, the first one, of course, is, as you can imagine, the way in which Russia has emerged as a great power, as a rival, as a competitor, even as a threat, in the sense that, you know, some officials in the alliance, like Joe Dunford, the American chief of the defense staff, testifying to Congress, you know, said quite frankly, Russia is the number one threat to us. That's not a consensual view, because a couple of days later, James Clapper, the head of the coordinator for national intelligence in the United States, said cyber threats were the number one threat to the United States. But of course, many people have cited Russia on the back of its behavior in the wake of Crimea and Eastern Ukraine. And of course, if you're looking at a state like Russia, you've got certain ingredients which play into NATO's history and into the DNA of what we've been used to be doing for the last 60 years. Number one, you've got a classic threat, which expresses itself in classic ways through tanks and aircraft and snap exercises and military posturing on your border. So border defense, deterrence, the tripwire of credibility. If you attack me, you attack all of the allies, and escalation is more or less pre-programmed. Those are things that we may have to rediscover, but we were doing them for the last 50 years, and so we haven't totally forgotten how to do them. Number two, it's easier to deal with the East because it's confined space. If we are having a rivalry with the Russians, it's in a very narrow part of the Baltic Sea. It's in a narrow strip of the Black Sea. We even obsess now about the Suvlaki Gap, which is the link between Poland through just by Kaliningrad and the Baltic states, in the way that we obsessed about the fall of the gap. You remember that? At least the people of my generation in the audience during the Cold War. We're on our own territory. Of course, defence, it's much easier to operate when you're doing it on your own territory. You don't need status of forces agreements or partnerships with other countries. We're dealing with a single actor. In other words, we can either persuade Putin to change course by rational measures. One is deterrence, one economic sanctions, incentives, diplomacy, in a way that you cannot change the mentality of ISIL through incentives or diplomacy or sanctions or whatever. So there's still some sort of hope out there that Putin will wake up tomorrow and decide that Crimea and Eastern Ukraine were mistakes, the sanctions are biting, the Russian economy shows that. It's time to reverse course. And within a week or so, the NATO-Russia Council will be back up and running. Chancellor Merkel this afternoon made it clear that Russia can have the sanctions lifted very, very quickly if it meets the provisions of the Minsk II agreement for Eastern Ukraine. Frankly, forgive me, but when your girlfriend leaves you and goes off and comes back, you can reconcile. It's not quite the same as it used to be before she left you, right? You know, you may be a little bit more cautious, maybe less romantic, but you can get the household back up and running fairly quickly. And everything that NATO has been doing, and I'll come back to this in a moment vis-a-vis Russia, over the last year or so, is designed with an inbuilt off-ramp. In other words, that, you know, we can escalate, but we can de-escalate. In other words, you know, whatever we do it in a way to get out again. It's like going into a maze and leaving a piece of string behind you, so that no matter how far into the maze you go, you can get back out if the political opportunity presents itself. And therefore, ultimately, we can talk to the Russians. The Secretary General met Lavrov in Munich for a bilateral. The Russian ambassador visits us every day. We may not find it very productive at the moment, but we keep probing each other on both sides for ways in which we can compromise. I mean, we say that, you know, to the Russians, we want to talk about Ukraine. They say, no, you're going to beat us up on Ukraine. Let's talk about Afghanistan, where you guys look bad because you haven't managed to defeat the Taliban despite all of your efforts, and we can hammer you on the head for that. So we've got different agendas, and we're both sort of, you know, creeping closer together in the sense of whether we can define a package of so-called confidence-building transparency measures, risk reduction measures, to reduce the potential of clashes in the Baltic, in the Black Sea, that could lead to incidents. But, you know, there is a mechanism there to at least get some idea of what the other guy's bottom line is and where we can ultimately go back to a dialogue. If nothing else, a dialogue at least makes it clear what NATO's red line is, what Russia's red line is, and therefore reinforces the notion of deterrence. Of course, all of that totally impossible when one looks at the jihadist movements of the South. So don't be surprised, ladies and gentlemen, to discover that, you know, NATO has got out of the starting blocks much faster in developing a strategy for the East than a strategy for the South. The strategy for the East, however, does present a number of difficult choices. The first thing is there is a big debate at the moment in the alliance between the Eastern Europeans and the Western Europeans, grosso modo. The Western Europeans would like to secure the East through a policy of reinforcement. In other words, let's not have lots of big heavy tank units in Poland or the Baltic states. Let's not have a Brunson, for example, in Tallinn or a Ramstein. Let's, you know, use the fact that it would take Russia several weeks to constitute a big military force on our borders to mobilize forces from Western Europe into Eastern Europe. What are the advantages of this? It's not threatening to the Russians, or less threatening, number one. Number two, those forces that are in Western Europe can go south if necessary. So we have greater flexibility over their use. We're not parking them with expensive infrastructure, pouring cement, sunk investments in Eastern Europe in a way that would mean that they can only be used there, they can't be used anywhere else. And thirdly, we made a commitment to Russia in 1997 that we would not station substantial combat forces, on the territory of the new member states, and let's therefore not give Russia a kind of propaganda excuse against us by now being seen to be breaking that promise. The Eastern Europeans, as you could imagine, don't buy into this at all. They feel, hey, wait a minute, you know, if you talk about rapid reaction, what is the fastest way to get somewhere? It's to be there already, right? To be on the spot. with multinational brigades forward deployed on the borders, the tripwire of the Cold War. That is the best form of deterrence. Secondly, the Eastern Europeans argue that the Russians can mobilize much faster than you think they can. They've demonstrated through a number of snap exercises, including in Eastern Ukraine, that they can actually maneuver with a corps level or 120,000 troops extremely quickly on our borders, and therefore don't think that you're going to have a lot of warning time that you can use to call up reinforcements. Thirdly, you know, what if NATO hesitates? You know, what if NATO can't decide because it's not clear if we're looking at a Russian exercise? Remember, those of you who are historians, remember Czechoslovakia in 1968 when the Soviet Union disguised an invasion of Czechoslovakia to exterminate the Prague Spring. It was disguised as an exercise. We were fooled. In NATO at the time, at least for a while, and therefore we need this forward deployed presence which will convince Russia not to mess with us, that we are serious. The next argument of the Eastern Europeans, which is one which is developing, is a debate which we call in the military community A2AD. Some of you who follow this will be familiar, anti-access area denial. There's a similar debate in the South China Sea. It's the idea that, you know, Russia, like China, have got masses of standoff missiles, electronic jamming, advanced cyber offensive capabilities. They've got anti-air, you know, the S-300s that they've deployed in Syria. They've got anti-ship missiles. And these can effectively stop NATO reinforcing. They can destroy ports, they can destroy rail networks, they can destroy roads, they can deprive us of access to our own airspace. And this would make reinforcements, which are already difficult in peacetime circumstances, much more difficult in a hostile environment. So the fear of the Eastern Europeans is, A, NATO may not decide quickly, but even if it did, it could not maybe get the forces in. And the last couple of days, there have been some fairly alarmist things in the media that you may have picked up here in the Netherlands. So one was a report by the RAND Corporation that got a lot of traction in Brussels that demonstrated that under current force postures, NATO would lose quickly, within 48 hours, that's what RAND said, to a Russian attack on the Baltic states. And it advocated that the minimum would be seven heavy armoured brigades to be able to hold the line before the reinforcements in NATO arrived. And that would cost about 3.7 billion extra dollars a year to do. For the time being, the United States has committed to one heavy brigade and one lighter brigade, but not on a permanent basis, on a rotational basis. That's to say that there will always be Americans there, but they won't be the same Americans. You know, they'll leave 500 tanks there and armored personnel carriers and command and control, but different units in the United States, the 7th Armored Cavalry Regiment, the 1st Armored Division, will rotate in and out, you know, for 3 months, practice with the equipment and then go back. So persistent, but not permanent. And the second media thing, which you may have seen, is called World War III on BBC just 2 weeks ago. Maybe you'll get it on Dutch TV, which was using a lot of British personalities, the former deputy SACEUR, former senior officials in the Ministry of Defence, who did a kind of war game, a simulation exercise, same conclusion, with its present posture, NATO would lose. And these may have been sort of think tank and media reports, but they've fed in Eastern Europe a sense of alarm that the posture may be too light. And the new Polish government, as you've seen, particularly as it's hosting the NATO summit in Warsaw in July, really wants to make this the summit of deterrence, where we transition from the current arrangement, which is an arrangement whereby we organise permanent sort of quick exercises, so-called assurance measures on the territory of the new member states. You've seen this, you know, small units rehearsing, exercising. They've got no combat capability but such, but they wave the flag and they're multinational. They show that NATO is there. The Poles at Warsaw want to transition from that to a long-term, sustainable, permanent type of military posture, which sort of hunkers down for the 10, 20, 30, who knows many years it's going to take before we once again have a 1989 moment and are able to move beyond that particular paradigm. Now, the good news is the Americans have signed up for a lot of this with $3.4, as I've mentioned, $1 billion, which President Obama announced in the new defense budget. The problem, of course, though, is that the Americans at the very maximum will only have 30,000 troops in Europe, compared with 326,000 and 7,000 nuclear weapons during the days of the Cold War. Now, one can argue that, again, Russia's not the Soviet Union, so you don't need to go back to 326,000 troops, but will 30 be too modest? You know, how can we sort of posture ourselves so that we get, you know, maximum value, deterrent effect from very limited resources? It's a little bit like, you know, the siege of Jericho in the Old Testament, where the Israelis, you know, did brilliantly by smoke and mirrors, making such a noise and creating such a pandemonium that they convinced their adversaries that they were 10 times stronger than they really were. So how do we sort of posture ourselves in a way that maximizes deterrence from ultimately a modest base? The American idea is that the divisions will have to be multinational, which means that there will have to be a degree of self-help from the countries of Eastern Europe. Americans point out that, you know, they are putting in a lot of effort into Eastern Europe, where most of the countries in the region who feel threatened spend just above 1% of their GDP on defence. And so there is a bit of a dichotomy. Hey, you know, we're helping you, but you guys are, you know, even though you argue that you're under an existential threat, think of Latvia, Lithuania, until very recently, are spending, you know, only 1% of your GDP on defence. So there's got to be more of a mobilisation of the countries concerned. And the second thing is that the Europeans in general are going to have to participate in this structure much more visibly than they did during the Cold War. And so what is the European Union, the European NATO contribution going to have to be to this? Now, in NATO, obviously, we recognise that, you know, we need to Europeanise this if the Americans are going to stay. The United States is currently 73% of the total NATO budget, 73%, one ally, whereas even 15 years ago, it was still basically 50-50. The Europeans have now gone down to a 1.1% average on defence spending. Many large countries like Spain or Italy hover around 1%. Germany is 1.2%, notwithstanding the size of its economy. Even France, which of course is taking defence extremely seriously and cancelled all of its budget and personnel cuts after the November attacks in Paris, but even France is well below 2%, notwithstanding these efforts. In fact, although NATO, to great fanfare at the last summit in Wales, established a benchmark that we would all spend 2% of our GDP on defence, currently only four allies, including my own country, the United Kingdom, UK, Greece, and should Greece be spending 2% given its economic situation? But it does. And Estonia actually meet this figure, albeit that many others have, you know, at least stabilised, stopped the rot, made commitments to gradually move forward. But clearly, there is an urgency now to organise a better European defence effort. For example, if all of the European countries met the 2% benchmark, NATO would have nearly just under 100 billion euros a year more to spend on modernising its armed forces. It's a very large amount of money. McKinsey, you're familiar with McKinsey, of course, the management consulting company, did a study for the European Parliament last year before the EU held its first defence summit for many years, and figured out that, you know, duplication, lack of role specialisation, you know, too many bases, too much infrastructure in Europe was costing Europe 25 billion euros a year in lost revenue. And certainly when you look around the European Union in terms of defence, it's not very impressive. I mean, one of my favourite stories is the NH90 helicopter, which is now coming on stream. And because every European country has a different airworthiness, air safety certification system, we had to spend 4 billion euros just getting the helicopter certified as airworthy to fly. And for that, you could have doubled the fleet of these capabilities. And when you look, you know, at Europe in terms of the, you know, the 13 different armoured personnel carriers, the four different fighter aircraft, the four different main battle tanks that we produce, you know, compared with the United States, which has done a great deal of rationalisation, it's clear there's a long way to go. So the other challenge that we need to think about at NATO in the long run is how do we do things in a way that sort of encourage the Europeans to take on a more greater responsibility and develop more capacity. I mean, let me just give you two very brief examples before moving on. One is framework nations. In Europe, if you count the United States, 88% of all of the defence spending is just by the big European four plus the US. So the others are there, but don't contribute very much. Half the countries in NATO have armies of under 15,000, and five NATO countries have armies of fewer than 5,000. So it's what the big countries do that matters. And here, what we're trying to do is get those big countries, the UK, Germany, France, Italy, Spain, to act as framework nations where they, and the Germans in fact are now pushing this quite well forward, the British are doing it with the Scandinavians, of tying countries, the Dutch are doing it with the Germans, particularly, you know, with reviving tank formations in Germany, is to try, you know, the Benelux, but to try to build these kind of defence clusters around a big country which provides the backbone and the small countries that slot in. And the if this succeeds, it will mean that at least for the first time since the Cold War, the Europeans will take on a significant role in Eastern Europe by organising the training for the Baltics and the Poles and providing the headquarters structures. These will not be American headquarters, they'll be European headquarters, even though directing American forces. The second idea is that as the EU stands up its own forces, whether it be maritime forces or the EU battle groups, that we train them as part of the big program of exercises that we're developing now to get back into the habit of collective defence, so that gradually, you know, we form sort of more coherent European units, which can then be slotted in to collective defence roles in the East. That's going to take some time, but if we're going to be successful, that's the direction, ladies and gentlemen, that we need to go in. The second issue that we face, looking beyond the collective defence, is hybrid warfare. There's a lot of hullabaloo in Brussels about hybrid warfare. A friend of mine, you may know him, he's a famous Belgian strategist, Sven Biskop, calls it hybrid hysteria. And he may have a point, because, you know, after the little green men in eastern Ukraine and the Crimea, you know, there's a lot of sort of soul searching in Brussels, both in the EU and NATO. Can they do the same to us? You know, are we vulnerable? I mean, we've just done a massive study in NATO on critical infrastructure, which points out that, you know, if we need to move troops around today, 90% of the networks are now in the hands of the private sector. Cyberspace, bandwidth, communications, ports. You know, Ryanair controls all the air corridors that we used to fly in Central and Eastern Europe. And you can't get the private sector to give it to you in the way that it could when it was British Railways or everything was owned by a government. And secondly, we've discovered that to support our forces in the field, unlike the Cold War today, 75% of all of the support comes from private companies. Who owns those companies, for example? How can you be certain of your supply chain management? You know, what do you do if your food stocks are polluted? What do you do if vital critical infrastructure is taken out? You know, during the Cold War, there was no problem with this because we had loads of redundancy. Now, because of the private sector, forgive me, we have fantastic profits, just-in-time delivery, and no redundancy. If one system is out, that's it. We're blind. We've even discovered, you may be interested in this, that we need 88 legal agreements between allies to move our very high readiness forces from Western Europe into Central Europe, because all of these legal agreements that, you know, you can be on my territory and move to your territory, lapsed after the Cold War. One of the areas that I'm particularly involved in personally is cyber, you know, where we have this big worry, you know, what about credibility of our command and control systems, our military equipment to major cyber attacks. You know, Russia is recently credited with having taken out the Ukrainian electricity grid very effectively through a black energy malware virus. They have interfered with air traffic control at Kiev airport. The Georgians have had their systems badly affected. So in NATO, you know, we're not quite sure how vulnerable we are to all of this, and nobody wants to say, you know, if it happened to Ukraine, it can happen to us. For example, I know that, for example, the Ukrainian cyber systems were all operated by Russian software. So clearly there was a degree of vulnerability there. But still, you know, we're in an age where often in the cyber domain, you don't really know ultimately where your chips come from. The American Pacific Fleet has just had to totally overhaul its information technology when they discovered that the software was being provided by a Chinese company. And so they've had to sort of go back to scratch. So hybrid warfare has now become the flavour of the month, and resilience. If you're in Brussels, the big R word, resilience, you hear everywhere. You know, if we're going to be attacked, where's our Achilles heel? We actually are discovering with Mr. Putin and Aleppo at the moment that the Achilles heel may be migrants from the south, rather than, you know, electrons through cyberspace from the east. It's not always where you think the threat's going to come from. But basically, you know, what are we going to do about this? And in NATO, we've picked up a few problems. Number one, lack of intelligence, early warning. You know, it's a big issue. If there's a hybrid warfare thing going on, how do you discover it? How do you know it's the real thing, as opposed to simply, you know, a kid in the attic trying to hack into your system? How do you distinguish between decoys and real attacks, for instance? In the cyber domain, for example, which is a big debate, you know, do we need offensive cyber of our own as a deterrent, or can we still get by with deterrence as I deny you entry into my system? Can we go into the grey area? For example, if you're in the cyber domain, you know, there's my cyberspace, there's the adversary's cyberspace, and there's this massive thing called the internet in the middle, which is the sort of the common communicating network of the world. Well, at the moment, we don't go outside our own space. But if we want to do active cyber, can we go into the middle space and start probing around in there, looking for attacks against us? These are big debates that we're having to sort of get a grip with in Brussels, and it's all coming from this lack of intelligence, this idea that, you know, the information is going to be fragmentary. Is it a duck? Does it quack like a duck? Does it look like a duck? How can we be sure? How can we stop, you know, endless arguments in the alliance about, is it the real thing or not? And there's a big push on in where we call strategic foresight analysis, scenarios, and early warning indicators. I mean, if after this lecture I say, boys and girls, ladies and gentlemen, go out into the streets of Maastricht and find me that dog, you're going to think, well, what's this? Shea's gone completely crazy. What does he mean? What dog am I looking for? Am I looking for an Alsatian, a Chihuahua, five-legged dog, four-legged dog, dog with a pink bow tie? How do I know what I'm looking for until I see it? And so we're very deep at work in NATO in trying to develop a better sense of situational awareness so we can pick up indications early of hybrid warfare scenarios. We're looking at improving our resilience. This, by the way, is also tying us in with the European Union, where we're having a big dialogue now with the other side of Brussels, particularly with the European Commission, which handles, of course, internal security for the EU, on how we can sort of share best practices in critical infrastructure, civil military preparedness, strategic communications, so that we can control our media area better at a time when Sputnik or the Russian TV stations, particularly in Eastern Europe, particularly in Germany, have achieved a very high degree of penetration, so we're not so vulnerable to disinformation campaigns. How do we look at, for example, the situation of ethnic minorities? All of these things. In fact, last week, we, for the first time, you may laugh because you may feel that this is small, but for us it's important, we actually signed the first ever cyber cooperation agreement between NATO and the EU, so that what they're seeing in the cybercrime area, where often cyber attacks are organised by international criminal groups acting as proxies for the state, that DNA, that malware, can be contrasted with what we're seeing in the military intelligence area, and we can exchange that kind of information and the common kind of analytical unit. We're even thinking of common, my God, this is revolutionary stuff, you know, common exercises with the EU to test our procedures for how we help with a hybrid attack as well. The problem here is that the less information you have in order to base a decision, the more you have to rely on that information. It's rather like, you know, you've seen these sports programs where you have to guess the identity of a sports personality and they put pieces of a jigsaw puzzle up, huh? And the prize goes to the guy who says, ah, it's David Beckham, you know, even with, you know, three or four pieces of the jigsaw puzzle. And we're in that kind of dilemma. And one of the things we're doing now, which we haven't done for years, is getting the NATO ambassadors to really put themselves through the mill of simulation exercises, crisis management exercise scenarios, where they try in real time under the pressures of real life to take various decisions. So that we get back into the habit of crisis management. You've got to remember, we've come out of Afghanistan of 10 years of having months, knowing that, you know, the Dutch were going to Helmand or Oruzgan, months to prepare, months to gather all of the facts, you know, months to talk to everybody, knowing everything. And now we're in the area of calculated ambiguity, but the need to decide. And of course, also, what delegation do we give to our military authorities here on hybrid warfare, on activating the very high readiness forces, for example, on doing offensive cyber operations? What, you know, power do we give to them, and what political control do we continue to exert over those military authorities? Successful crisis management is a bit of both, but finding the fine line isn't easy. As we move forward on the East, we of course have the issue of what to do about the states in between. Unlike the Cold War, we now have a number of countries whose destiny is still in the balance. You think of Ukraine, where the president has now fired the prime minister, or at least called on him to resign this afternoon. You have Moldova, where the forces that call themselves European, unfortunately, are the ones tainted by the most corruption. You think of the frozen conflicts in Georgia and elsewhere, where countries may look to the West, but of course are economically, socially, in many respects culturally, still very much tied to Russia, and where we have, let's face it, a big competition strategically. No sense in denying it between ourselves and the Russians over the fate of those countries. And of course there are three theories of this. One is that the aim is to get them into our camp entirely. The other one is let them go to Russia, because at least then that will satisfy the Russians and bring us peace. And the third one is, as you can imagine, very much that somehow we should have some kind of sharing arrangement, often called Finlandization, i.e. that they can be part of the West economically, but strategically still be neutral. But clearly what is the key is that before it's too late, in places like Georgia and Ukraine and Moldova, which are under enormous domestic pressures and not necessarily making a good job of reforming themselves, we've got to find a way of moving forward here. Stopping the conflict in Ukraine is good, because they're spending 2 million euros a day, which they need to spend on other things, sustaining the conflict in eastern Ukraine. But we've got to get out of 20 years when it was you pretend to reform and I'll pretend to help you. And here again, we need a better quality of dialogue with the European Union. So we use the same incentives, the same carrots and sticks to move these areas forward. The South. Yap is telling me my time's up, and I've got to say a few words about the South. The South is more difficult, obviously. Where do you start? The problem in the South is the negativity is interconnected, but the positivity isn't. What do I mean by this? Let's say that tomorrow we have a peace agreement between Arabs and Israelis. It's not likely, I know. Two states, Israel and Palestine. 20 years ago, or even recently, Petraeus, when he was testifying to Congress, said, you know, if we can get that, that's the solution to the Middle East. Who would say that now? We'd celebrate it, but then realise that its effects beyond the immediate microcosm of of the Sea of Galilee were pretty sort of minimalist. So that's the problem. The positivity doesn't go across borders. The negativity, unfortunately, does. The reconstruction costs are horrendous. For example, a couple of days ago, the Iraqis liberated Ramadi with a bit of help from the Americans. The cost of rebuilding Ramadi calculated at $12 billion. That's just one destroyed city. If you look at, you know, Syria, if you look at the rest of Iraq, you know, if you look at Libya, you look at Benghazi, this is going to make the Marshall Plan look like pocket money for one day when we eventually come to it. Where do we even begin? In the south, you know, you've got to work with local actors. Who are the viable partners? The problem is also that different people have different agendas. Whether you like it or not, the Russians, the Iranians, Assad are basically on the same line, pursuing the same policies. The other side, our side, we're not always on the same line or pursuing the same policies. ISIS may be the number one target for the United States, but it's not the number one target for many of the other countries in the region who've got bigger enemies closer to home, even before they get to ISIS. And of course, as each person fights their own particular enemy, the beneficiary is ISIS, that sort of walks into territory without a fight, evacuated because other people are fighting. So the first thing we have to do is get our own camp aligned behind a clear, consistent policy. And what do we have to do? I mean, you asked me to comment on the Kurds and the Turks and Russia. Well, clearly, you know, if the Turks are going to insist that they do not want an independent Kurdish state, and they feel very strongly about this, it's really a bottom line. The quid pro quo is that President Erdogan obviously has to sort of resuscitate the outreach to the old PKK political elements and the PYD, the Kurdish party, which is in the parliament in Turkey, and start that process, which he did successfully at the beginning, you know, because you can't, you know, have both denial outside your territory and denial inside your territory. I mean, it's just one example of the debates that we're going to have. What can NATO do? Very briefly, because my time is up. I mean, obviously, the first thing is we've got to at least protect those islands of decency where they exist. I mean, there's so few of them in the Middle East. You think of Tunisia, you think of Jordan, Morocco, not many others, frankly, where you've got some kind of democratic system, not perfect. You've got strain, for example. The Jordanians pointed out at NATO's meeting last week that proportionately, if we receive the number of refugees that they have proportionately, second largest city in Jordan is a refugee camp, then we would be talking about 50 million refugees, not just 1 million. So get an idea of the type of pressures that they are under at the moment. The Iraqis, to the extent that they're willing to work for reconciliation between Shia and Sunni, to some degree the Kurds, who at least have been effective at fighting ISIS, but only when it comes to liberating their own territory. We've got to help them much more. Defence capacity building is the mantra of the day, but we've got to take it more seriously, and we've got to be prepared to do it in non-permissive environments. Again, big issue here. Should we go deep and focus all of our efforts on one or two places? Should we go wide and have programs in a number of countries? What about the EU? Should we have the division of labor? We do Iraq, the EU does, for example, the Sahel. Or should we, as I would personally like, particularly with Libya, where the next big challenge is coming, put our assets more closely together? Another thing is migrants. You saw last week that NATO, to great fanfare, launched a operation in the Aegean, led by Germany, with five ships to look at the migrant situation. The advantage there is that it gets the Greeks and the Turks talking to each other via NATO. But what can we usefully do apart from sailing up and down and passing on information intelligence? What are going to be the rules of the engagement? How can we avoid creating a public impression that we're militarizing this, or that we see migrants who are helpless, poor people who have suffered appalling violence, that we see migrants as somehow as a threat, which they're clearly not? We don't have the answer to that yet. because the military are still working up a plan. But that's at least perhaps a contribution that NATO could make to a better kind of arrangement between Turkey and the European Union in terms of trying to stop or slow down or control the flow. And at the very least, break up the smuggling networks that are making massive profits out of the misery of human beings. So we managed it successfully against piracy in the Gulf of Aden, where we virtually eliminated the problem, at least for now. And so we need to look at that. And this also could be an opportunity, ladies and gentlemen, to work with the European Union and Frontex and the new European sort of border policy, which, like hybrid warfare, would be another way of bringing the two organisations more closely together. Finally, should NATO join a coalition? Big debate. The 60 countries in the coalition against ISIL. There are differences of view here. The Americans would like us to. The French and the Germans think no. After Libya, let's not have NATO. Particularly if we're working, trying to work with the Russians, getting involved in the Middle East, better that we keep a low profile. Although we have offered AWACS aircraft, air monitoring aircraft, to help the coalition, but should NATO be more involved there? But the fact of the matter is, as I say, in the Middle East, we need to improve the quality of our political relationships with partners. We need to build better trust. We need to work more with the EU, with the African Union, in particular with the United Nations, that now has nearly 4/5 of all of its peacekeepers in the world in Africa. And it's demonstrated, with the African Union, places like Somalia, that it can adopt a robust approach. And we've obviously got to, with the EU, develop a maritime strategy for the Mediterranean. This is all groping in the dark, but at least it's the beginning of a strategy. So, ladies and gentlemen, let me conclude, because Jaap will be sort of escorting me out of the room before we've had a chance for any discussion. When we get to Warsaw, three headlines: an effective system of deterrence, but minimal deterrence. Not too, like Goldilocks, and the three bears. The porridge must be not too hot, not too cold, just right. A strategy for the south as well, two, very important, and some degree of cooperation with the European Union, particularly on hybrid warfare. Looking ahead, new US administration coming in, who God knows who it's going to be. I mean, it's almost as unpredictable as the Champions League. But we need a better quality of debate. Too much of the last 4 or 5 years, frankly, has been the US saying, what can the Europeans do for us? And the Europeans are saying, how can we continue to put the burden on the Americans? In other words, NATO's the other guy. NATO's not us. NATO is what the other guy does for me, not what I do. Let's be honest about this. We really need to have now a much better quality of transatlantic dialogue about how we sort of face the threats together. Not what I was hearing in Munich, which is, how can we Americans help you with the migration crisis? It's much too late for that kind of discussion. So that's the first thing we need. Secondly, we need, of course, over the long run, to have an effective system of deterrence and dialogue with Russia. Not easy, but we managed it during the Cold War, and we have to do it again. Thirdly, we need to save the countries in between before they go down the drain, whether it be the Balkans, destabilized by the migrant crisis, or countries in Eastern Europe like Ukraine. They don't always make it easy for us, let's be honest. Look at corruption in Ukraine, but we have to do it. The stronger Ukraine is, for example, as a resilient democracy, the less chance that there'll be Russian tanks on NATO's border tomorrow, and the more chance that Russians themselves will democratize in the future. We have to take this more seriously instead of giving up at the first obstacle. And then finally, we've got to keep our network of partnerships in the alliance. One of the things that we did very successfully over the last 20 years, on the back of Afghanistan, is bring in Sweden, bring in Finland, even Switzerland or Ireland, Austria, New Zealand, Japan, Australia, into collective efforts with the alliance, which provided legitimacy, made us look good in the United Nations. At one stage, 15% of all of our troops in Afghanistan were from non-NATO countries. And those are precious, precious relationships. We've got to preserve them, and somehow get the more active partners to contribute resources with us into this capacity building for the least capable countries. And if I can be allowed, in 10 nanoseconds, just one concluding thought. One thing that does concern me, particularly at a time when norms are disappearing, you know, what are the rules of engagement for droning people? What are the rules of engagement for offensive cyber attacks? So much warfare today is covert warfare, isn't it? You know, we're at war, but we don't declare it. You know, the last time the United States declared war on anybody was in 1942. And yet, we've been involved in lots of conflicts ever since. Do we need a UN Security Council resolution or not? If China, you know, creates facts on the ground, or Russia creates facts on the ground, and that's international law, do we do the same? You know, I was pointing out to Yap over dinner that the paradox of the Cold War Mark II, and you'll be amazed, is there are fewer arms control agreements between Russia and NATO today than between the Soviet Union and NATO in the 1990s. And the more you go back to military strength, which is what's happening, you know, we're building up missile defense, we're building up the armed forces again, you know, we're increasing defense budgets as much as we can, you know, we're going back to hard power rather than soft power. The more we have to balance that by also being actively involved in the global debate on norms and regulations, you know, to put this structure, even though it's been violated by Russia, for example, back in place. For example, I'm acutely aware, you know, just like in the nuclear field, the more you build nuclear weapons, the more you need hotlines, you need START treaties, you know, you need reduction treaties, you need mutual understanding of, between with the other guy about how deterrence is going to function and what you mean by it. You know, the more we NATO look at offensive cyber capabilities, the more we've got to start looking at how we prevent a kind of free-for-all, you know, cyber warfare in future. And what, you know, for example, the US has just signed an agreement with China ruling out attacks on critical infrastructure. I mean, okay, maybe it's not going to work, but at least the norm is established. And it's going to be very important in NATO that we also move on the political normative front, not only because it's in our defense interest to prevent this kind of chaotic world, but also because I think in the wider community it will legitimize more what we are doing. Thank you very much indeed. Thank you for listening.
Thank you very much. Thank you all for listening.